In this video, we are checking out the Blazor Web App, a new template that came out with .NET 8. Most of the steps for building it are like the previous templates, but there are few things that are different. We'll talk about those in this video. So let's get started. I'll choose the option to create a new project in Visual Studio. Now, under the Project Types filter, let's select Blazor. At the top of the list, you'll find the Blazor Web App template. Let's go ahead and select that. Just a note, I'm using .NET 8 as the framework for this project. Here, we have the option to choose render modes. We'll be discussing render modes in detail shortly. There are four options: None, Server, WebAssembly, and Auto, which is a combination of both Server and WebAssembly. There is another drop-down here for selecting the interactivity location with two options, per page or component, and global. If we choose the global option, the interactive render mode we selected will be applied globally in the application. However, we can change it later if needed. I'll demonstrate it how. On the other hand, selecting the second option allows us to specify the render modes for the components based on our specific requirements. These options provided by Visual Studio are for our convenience, and we can modify them even after creating the project. If you choose the interactive mode as server and interactivity location as global, the application will function like a typical Blazor server app, similar to what was available in .NET 7. On the other hand, if you select the interactive render mode as WebAssembly and interactivity location as global, the application will behave like a standard Blazor WebAssembly app from .NET 7. So, there are insignificant differences, and most of the concepts remains the same. You can find more detailed explanations of Blazor in our previous videos of the Blazor tutorial series. You can locate the playlist link in the video description. Now, let's take a look at the projects created by selecting different options. In the Solution Explorer, you can observe that I have already set up three folders: Blazor Server App, Blazor WebAssembly App, and Blazor Auto App. The projects inside the Blazor Server App folder were created by choosing the interactive render mode as server. Within this folder, I've created two additional folders: Global Interactive and Component Interactive. Now, let's take a look at the project inside the Global Interactive folder. For this project, I chose the interactive location as global. In the program.cs class, you'll notice a method called addInteractiveServerComponents being called. This method adds services to support rendering interactive server components. Additionally, addInteractiveServerRenderMode method is called to configure the server render mode for the app. Next, let's open the app.razor component, which serves as the root component of the Blazor application. In this file, you can see that the render mode is assigned as interactive server for the routes component. Additionally, you'll notice a component named HeadOutlet with the interactive server render mode. We'll delve into the details of HeadOutlet and its uses later in this video. Now, let's shift our focus to the component interactive folder. This project was created by choosing the interactive location as per page or component. In the program.cs class, there aren't many differences. You'll notice both add interactive server components and add interactive server render mode, similar to what we observed in the previous server global project. However, in the app.razor component, you'll observe that no render modes are assigned for the head outlet and routes component. We have the flexibility to assign render modes for the Razor components based on our specific requirements, and I'll demonstrate that shortly. Moving on, let's explore the WebAssembly projects. Firstly, let's examine the Global Interactive app. Here, you'll notice two projects. For both WebAssembly and Auto, we'll be having two projects, a server-side project and a client-side project. The components that need to be rendered on the client side can be placed in the client side project. In the program.cs class of the server side project, you'll observe that the addInteractiveWebAssembly components method is called instead of the addInteractiveServerComponents method used in the previous project. Additionally, you'll see the use of the addInteractiveWebAssemblyRenderMode method, which configures the WebAssembly render mode for the app. There is an extra line for adding the assembly of the client-side project. You can specify any component from the client-side project here. In this case, the counter component is mentioned, but it can be any component in the client-side project. Since this is a global interactive app, you'll find that render modes are specified directly in the app.razor component. For both HeadOutlet and routes, the render mode is assigned as Interactive WebAssembly. Now, moving on to the component Interactive Project. In the program.cs class, you'll find no differences as we observed in the server projects. The distinction lies in the app.razor component, where the render modes are not assigned for HeadOutlet and routes. As mentioned earlier, we'll assign the render modes at the component level, and we'll explore that shortly. Now, let's explore the projects created with the auto render mode. As mentioned earlier, this render mode is a combination of both server and WebAssembly. Similar to the WebAssembly project, here too, we have two projects, one for the server side and one for the client side. In the program.cs class of the server side project, you'll notice the utilization of both render modes. In the app.razor component, the render modes are specified as Interactive Auto. Since the render mode is auto, this application will initially be rendered entirely from the server. Simultaneously, it will download the assemblies and seamlessly transition to working entirely on the client side. Now let's proceed to the component Interactive Project. Similar to the previous project, the program.cs class remains the same. The distinction lies in the app.razor component, where no render modes are specified. As mentioned earlier, we'll assign the render modes at the component level, and that is what we are going to cover next. So let's delve deeper into render modes. I'll start by running the Blazor server app with the global interactive type. In the counter page, you'll notice a button that you can click to increase the count. Additionally, there is a weather page that initially displays a loading message and then loads the data into a table. Now let's attempt to change the render mode of this project. I'm removing the render mode from the routes component. Let's perform a hot reload. Additionally, I'll refresh the page. Here, we can observe that the home page is loading fine. Moving to the counter page, you'll notice that the button click is no longer functioning. Furthermore, when opening the weather page, you'll observe a slight delay and it no longer displays the loading message. Let's attempt to open the weather page again. The delay you are experiencing is due to the task.delay of 500 milliseconds mentioned in the onInitializedAsync method within the weather component. I'll modify it to 3000 milliseconds, which is 3 seconds. Now, let's try opening the weather page once more. You'll notice the URL change, but the component will only load after the specified waiting period. This behavior is occurring because we removed the render mode of the routes component in the app.razor. When there is no render mode assigned for a component, Blazor Web App considers the render mode as static render mode, which is the default render mode. In Blazor Web App, there are four distinct render modes. The first one is static, suitable for static pages, and it is the default render mode. The second one is interactive server, which is rendered by the server and utilizes web sockets for interactivity. The third one is interactive web assembly, where the entire rendering occurs on the client side and the necessary assemblies are downloaded to the client. The last one is interactive auto, a blend of both server and WebAssembly. Initially, the component is rendered from the server. Simultaneously, the application downloads the assemblies to the client. Once completed, it transitions to working entirely on the client side. By removing the render mode, we effectively transformed our application into a component interactive app. Now let's observe how the components are rendered in the actual component interactive project. In the counter raiser component, you'll notice a render mode specified within the component. As for the weather component, you'll observe the addition of the stream rendering attribute. This attribute is utilized to initially render the entire page swiftly with placeholder content while asynchronous operations are in progress. This approach aims to enhance the user experience. Now, let's implement the same in our previous project. In the counter raiser component, I'm adding the interactive server render mode. Let's run the application and test it. You can observe that now the button click in the counter page is displaying the incremental value, but the weather page still has the same behavior. Let's fix that as well. I'll be incorporating the stream rendering attribute to enhance the page's rendering process. Let's test it. Now, you'll notice that the weather page displays the loading message and the table data is populated after the specified waiting period. In summary, we have successfully transformed our global interactive application to a component interactive application. Now, let me create a new raiser component and I'll name it test component. I'm currently adding a button to the component labeled with the text click me. Additionally, I'll be creating a method to execute upon clicking the button and assigning it to the onClick event. We'll declare a private string variable initially set to an empty string. Upon clicking the button, we'll modify the value and I'll ensure to display this value within the component. Next, let's incorporate the new component into the home page. Upon running the application, I'll demonstrate how it functions. Presently, on the home page, you can observe the button. However, clicking the button won't trigger any action as the home page is currently utilizing static render mode. To resolve this, we need to assign the render mode for our new component, and there are two different approaches to achieve this. The first option involves assigning the render mode as a parameter in the home page. After a hot reload, you'll observe the message getting displayed when the button is clicked. Let me also demonstrate the second option. We can directly specify the render mode within the component itself. After performing a hot reload, you'll notice that the button click still functions as intended. Now, let me provide you with an overview of the project structure for a clearer understanding. Within the layout folder, you will find the main layout raiser component serving as the default layout for the entire application. Within this main layout component, the nav menu component is utilized and the body content is embedded here. The nav menu component contains the navigation options visible on the left side menu. For a comprehensive understanding of these raiser components and navigation details, you can refer to our earlier videos in this series. We have previously explored the components within the pages folder. Additionally, there is an important file called imports.raiser. This special file is utilized to declare global directives and namespace imports for a Blazor application. It enables you to define directives and namespaces that apply universally across all components in your Blazor application. Moreover, the router component facilitates the routing to raiser components, as we have observed in its usage within the app.raiser file. The project structure for both Blazor WebAssembly and Blazor Auto projects is identical, consisting of two projects, server-side and client-side. In the client-side project, you can organize raiser components meant for local rendering on the client-side. On the other hand, within the server-side project, you will find a single page where components intended for rendering from the server can be organized. As mentioned, you can find the same structure for a Blazor Auto Render Mode application. The key distinction lies in the fact that the components stored in the client project will undergo initial rendering from the server. Simultaneously, the application will progressively transition to working entirely on the client side by downloading the required files. Upon running the Blazor Auto Rendering application, you'll notice that it operates without any apparent delays for users. This is due to the initial server rendering, which ensures a smooth and responsive experience. If you would like a more in-depth explanation of Blazor WebAssembly functionality, detailed coverage is available in our previous videos. Now, let me guide you through some essential options that you should be aware of. In the app.razor component, we have previously observed the HeadOutlet component. This component is responsible for rendering content supplied by the page title and head content components. Let me show you an example. In a counter page, you'll notice the presence of the page title component. Now, let's consider a scenario where we need to include an additional CSS file exclusively for this counter page. I'll create a CSS file named mycustom.css, where I am defining a class selector to set the text color to red. Moving forward, in the counter page, we can utilize the head content component to incorporate a link to the newly created CSS file. Additionally, let's apply the new class to the H1 tag. I'll proceed to run the application now. Let's examine the page source of the home page and search for the reference to the mycustom.css file. However, it appears to be absent in the home page design. Now, I'll navigate to the counter page, where you can immediately notice the color change in the H1 tag. Upon inspecting the page source, we can find the reference to the CSS class. The head content component proves to be a valuable tool, allowing us to render distinct head content for different pages. Now, let's explore another highly useful component. I'll open the main layout and let's consider a scenario where we want to display a page title on the header bar. Let's check if the title is currently being displayed correctly. Indeed, we can see the page title is presented on the top right, which is satisfactory. However, our requirement is for the title to dynamically change based on the page the user is currently viewing. To fulfill this requirement, we can utilize the SectionOutlet component. I'll add the necessary namespace in the imports.razor to make it globally accessible. Now, let's assign a name to this SectionOutlet. I'll name it PageTitle. Now, in other pages, we can leverage the SectionContent component. It's important to ensure that you use the same name you assigned for the SectionOutlet. Inside the SectionContent component tag, include the necessary elements. I'll copy and paste this into the counter page, where we can modify the page title to be displayed. Now, as I run the application, you can observe that the home page title is displayed. In the counter page, the title has been updated accordingly. However, in the weather page, it doesn't show anything as we haven't provided the section content in that particular page. In essence, we can utilize section components to assign content from a child component to a parent component. In conclusion, we have navigated through various key components and functionalities within a Blazor web app. If you found this video helpful, don't forget to like, share, and subscribe the channel for more in-depth tutorials and insights into the world of .NET development. Thank you for watching and happy coding.